Okay, so what are we talking about today? Notation indicating columns, right? So this is an inline event. such an notation, we have been using I sub something to indicate the dimensions of it. That's not what we're doing here. We're using this to indicate the circumference of the second column. So what's the determinant of this? Well, if we do the cofactor expansion across this row right here, we'll find that all we get is 2. And that's going to be times the determinant. So we know x exists and it's unique. So there is some x. Without trying to figure out what it is, all of a sudden we have a formula for it. So for each of the entries, if we wanted to figure them out, we could say that the little space over here, this is a good x I is equal to determinant of a b divided by. This kind of silly idea of taking a matrix and replacing it with columns, we come up with a very interesting result. And this result is called Kramer's rule. Of course, named after Kramer from Seinfeld. And so this is really interesting. It's not particularly useful in practice. So actually computing each of these determinants, so we have to compute a determinant of this matrix right here for each of the entries that we would be trying to figure out, and also the determinant of it. It's a lot of computation. Some of it can be made redundant, but in general that's a lot of computation. And in practice it's just easier to do row reduction. So that's actually less computation. But it's useful theoretically because we can say that there's an actual formula for the entries of the solution. Now,
let's take this a step further. Maybe you want to try an example. Let's try an example. So let's pick a matrix at random. 1, 0, let's use it. 2, minus 1. All I have to do to make sure that this is a vertical matrix is this has to not be negative 2, right? Okay, so that
someone who did electrical engineering would be here today to hear me talk about the application in the book. It's an interesting application. We're going to skip it and you can look at it at home, but it's an application. It's called the Laplace Transform. You took it off for symbols are piling up in our imagination. Now, what are the properties of these entries? The properties are A prime inverse. So if we multiply A by the ith column, we should get the ith column of the identity matrix, right? Because A times A inverse is identity. That's the definition. So this should give us E prime. So in order to figure out the answer, we're going to use Cramer's rule to figure out the entries of that AI. So let's just real quick glance to make sure I'm not messing this up. So how do we get the solution to this? I'm going to have to pile on some more notation. So A, I, J, inverse will be the jth entry in this column, right? So if I pick the ith column and I go down J entries, this will be the jth entry. So this will be equal to, how do we get this? We take A, so now we have a formula for each entry in the inverse of A. Now, let's do a little more work to see if we can figure out what this should be. Determinant of A by E of I. Slight mistake here.
with the IJ entry, then we're going to look at, let's see, A inverse 0.1. That's going to be the one that we get when we look at the determinant of A with the first column replaced with 1. And so that will be what we get when we take the determinant of A with the first column and first row removed. So if I go down one, I'm going to be looking at A with the first column. I always have to work through the details of how this exactly works. So we'll be replacing the first column of A with E2. That means the second row will be removed in the first column. Anyway, if I get the rows and columns switched out, then you know, the details are removed. We just double check on that. If I want to get looking at the ith column, right? The column with second or subsquares, right? So the j should come first and the I should come second, which means what we're actually looking at here is C12. So this is the entry with the first row removed and the second column removed from it. So this is all the way down to C1N, and then this is C21, and we're going to start through C2N, and then down to C1N. Okay. Now, is sort of like an extension of that. It's a more broad version of the same thing, but it comes from very similar considerations. We're going to have something that's going to be divided out of the end. And like I was saying, these cofactors, that's what you get from getting the determinants of some matrices here. At each step, the only things that are involved in that computation are multiplication and addition, never division, right? So, in order to compute each of these cofactors, it was not ever necessary to say that we can't divide by zero, right? There was no denominator in all of these computations. So there's nothing that can ever go wrong. We can always do multiplication of two numbers. We can always do addition of two numbers. So we can always compute all of these determinants. So even if we have a non-vertical matrix, we have an adjunct for every square matrix, not just invertible matrices. Now, if it's not an invertible matrix, then this determinant here is going to be zero. And the full formula isn't going to work. But that's the only place it will fail. Right? This calculation is the only place that it will go wrong. So this thing is always computable as long as it's a square matrix. That's the first thing. And the second thing is, we only deal with, in our examples, matrices with whole numbers in them. Occasionally we end up with fractions, but in most cases we deal with just whole numbers. But we're really doing this with all real numbers, right? It doesn't have to be whole numbers in our matrices. It could be pi and e and square root of 2 and all of these other things in there. But when we compute the adjunct, or when we compute the determinants, we see that all it involves is multiplications and additions of whole numbers, which means that at the end, these are usually used when we're doing theoretical, when we're thinking about these things, when we're trying to prove things and say that certain properties of matrices exist. Very rarely are they used for computation. When the computations are very, very small like this, then it's the book also gives an example of when you have a 3x3 matrix with complex entries instead of real entries. A lot of times the computations get complicated because of the use of complex numbers. And so it actually turns out to, in some cases, be easier to use this kind of Cramer's rule to get to the solution. But for the most part, these are theoretical concerns. But this is an interesting thing about the adjunct. Same kind of matrix after this, even though this determinant here might be a whole number bigger than 1. And so when you divide by that to get the actual inverse, you might end up dividing by something that makes the entries. The entries of the inverse might be fractions. They might not be whole numbers anymore. But the adjunct still is. And so this is, for a lot of theoretical reasons, a really important idea. Matrix that's associated with this. What do we get? Let's call this the adjunct of A. We get this formula. A times the adjunct of A, not its inverse, equals
turns out to be very useful. Okay, I'm going to stop here for a second and make sure everyone has some time to ask questions. Remember, that's really how I want this class to go. Is I want to meet people to be asking me questions. It's better if I run out of time and I'm talking about something that's interesting to you as opposed to I spend all of my time just basically relating to you what the book already says. No questions. It's all really straightforward. It might be interesting to see what the attribute of a non-verbal matrix is. Let's come up with an example of one just really quickly. So, really, 0, 0. Is it obvious that this is not an invertible matrix? For many reasons, right? The determinant will be 0. We can see that when there's just so many 0 entries, we might expect we do the two factors, and it should be 0 immediately. This column is a multiple of this column, or vice versa. Not a necessary condition for it to be non-invertible, but it's sufficient, right? If I see two columns that are multiples of each other, immediately I doubt that these columns are linearly dependent, so the matrix is not invertible. Okay, let's try to compute this matrix right here. So this one, we got these entries by the ijth entry by deleting the jth row and ith column. So let's do this a little, I'm going to do this a little less less carefully. What I'm going to do is I'm going to just look at each of these entries. One times the cofactor, one times the determinant of the submatrix. That's the cofactor. So this will be 1 times 0, 2 times 0, 3 times 0. That's the determinant there. You notice I'm getting the rows and columns mixed up. I'm going to fix that at the end. So 0 times something, 0 times something, and then 4. Let's draw. And then here, it's going to be 0 times something, 0 times something, and 5 times 0 minus 0. So we end up just getting all zeros. I guess it really didn't matter that I had the rows and columns switched, but in the end, we would have to take the transpose of it in order to get the rows and columns, right? In this case, the attribute is just 0. And we see that if we multiply a by the attribute of a, we do get 0 times I, which is what we expected. If I had been a little more clever at picking the entries here, then we would have ended up with something that wasn't just a 0 matrix. Okay. Now they try to pile two, even though the adjugate is a really interesting, for theoretical reasons, a really interesting idea. They pile two concepts into this chapter. And so the other one is area for volume and the determinant. Okay. Area is a two-dimensional concept. Volume is a three-dimensional concept. There's an extension of this concept to higher numbers of dimensions, so I'll try to talk about what that means. But for the book, it is talking about the three dimensions. Like a small matrix anyway. A more general concept that works in any number of dimensions is called measure. And determinant will also be related to that in four dimensions or 10 dimensions or so on.
Okay. So, let's say, this is you. This is J. And so there's a parallelogram determined by those two, where this is this vector right here is equals B. Right? You remember this parallelogram. Okay, so if we have a we know this is true. Well, what would it be for a rectangle? A rectangle is going to have, rotating it, making a rectangle that's parallel to the coordinate axis. So this is U, this is V, this is the rectangle, and this would be U. Right? So U is going to be something in the x direction. We're thinking back to the ordinary coordinate system. And V will be something in the y direction. We'll call that A0 and 0B. When we put this in a matrix, we get A0, 0, 0, B. Or we could have these swap, and we could have 0B and 0. You already see what we're doing. Take the determinant, and we apply the absolute value if necessary. We get the absolute value of A times B, which is exactly what we expected. We left this could happen to anybody. So, okay. Now, we want to show that this is true for parallelograms in general. First of all, let's take a general parallelogram, and we'll make one of the sides parallel to the x-axis. Okay. It's just a rotation; it doesn't change the side. Actually, what we'll actually do is we're going to stick with the original example. Take some scaling of this vector and add it to this vector, right? To kind of shift it so that what we end up getting is something that's perpendicular to this, right? Now, what we're actually doing is taking this endpoint and shifting it to the right, and then we're taking this endpoint and shifting it to the right side. So this involved, this is U, this is V, this is took some multiple of u and we added it to v. Now, if instead of thinking of these as, say u is all vector AP, v is all CP, instead of putting them into the matrix as columns, let's put them in as rows. So, A, V, C, D. Now, if I take the determinant of this, or I take the determinant of its transpose, the one that we just came up is forming the matrix of these two columns. We know from the determinant rules that these are the same. So, it's no problem piling them in as rows instead of piling them in as columns. So no problem. And so what we did to get from this V to this V plus a multiple of U was that we added some multiple of U to V so that the entry, this entry, say we did a row operation that made this, make these two vectors perpendicular. In the old sense, in the geometric sense that we talked about earlier. Okay, so we do a row operation here. This is A, B, C plus S, A. So what we get ultimately is that the determinant of this, these two have the same area, and they have the same determinant, and so the determinant of this equals the area of this. Do a similar thing in three dimensions. We're within seconds of the first time we solved. So now, squeeze into the last little bit.